Welcome to Media Path. I'm Louise Palanker.
And I'm Fritz Coleman.
You know, Fritz, a podcast is sort of like an impression of a radio show. And in our case, it's an occasionally mediocre impression. But today on the show, we've got the guy who you first think of when you hear the word impression. Rich Little is a master mimic of over 200 impressions. Within the first 10 minutes of our show, he will have perfected his Fritz Coleman impression. And he is coming right up. But first, Fritz, what are you recommending for our viewing pleasure?
All right. Well, as you know, I'm a big fan of history.
Yes.
And in particular, American history. And in particular, the history of the Old West. And all the various Western heroes and anti-heroes of the mid and late 1800s. The greatest of these would be Wyatt Earp. One of my favorite movies of all time is Tombstone, which made heroes out of the Earp brothers and Doc Holliday. And a movie that came out at about the same time, unfortunately, which didn't get its due, was Wyatt Earp starring Kevin Costner. It was a good movie. It was long, but it was good. Both of these films were excellent, but left out a lot of history and shaded some of the history that they left in. A great new series on Netflix is Wyatt Earp and the Cowboy War. This is a docudrama, some excellent narration by Ed Harris, and the rest is reenactments with some good acting. The series picks up with a famous shootout at the OK Corral, which happened October 26, 1881. Wyatt and his brothers Virgil and Morgan, along with Doc Holliday, got in a shootout with Ike Clanton and his band of cowboys. Now, in those days, cowboy was a derogatory name, meaning ne'er-do-wells or criminals, generally grisly dudes of ill intent. They were kind of like the mafia at the time. Well, the shootout at the OK Corral literally only lasted 30 seconds, but almost changed history. The Clanton-McCleary gang had held up a Wells Fargo stage and stole the strongbox, leaving the stage driver dead. Now, the Earp brothers showed up to meet Ike and his boys at the OK Corral for some payback. One of the Clanton gang was killed, and two of the Earps were injured. Wyatt and Doc were arrested and jailed for murder. They were eventually set free, which rankled Ike, the cowboy, who ended up shooting Morgan Earp dead. Now, this is where most of the Wyatt Earp stories begin to fade out. But Wyatt, after that, went on a bloodthirsty redemption tour throughout the West, trying to avenge Morgan's death. This OK Corral story was so big, it was covered endlessly by newspapers at the time. The story ended up everywhere, including London, England. And this is fascinating, where it was followed with great concern by none other than J.P. Morgan. He was disturbed because all of the violence and robberies in the United States were keeping foreign investors from investing in the U.S. and in particular, the Western railroads that J.P. Morgan owned. So newspapers began to take sides. Remember, in 1881, the dust from the Civil War had not settled yet. Pro-Confederacy newspapers were siding with the Clanton cowboys. Pro-Union papers were siding with the Earps, representing law enforcement. The back and forth between the papers got heated. Some historians think that the shootout at the OK Corral almost reignited the Civil War. If you like history, it's a fantastic series. Right now on Netflix, it's about a week old over there.
Oh, wow. That sounds absolutely fascinating. I mean, we'll check that out. Fritz, I read Griffin Dunn's memoir. It's called The Friday Afternoon Club. Griffin Dunn's childhood stories are populated with such extraordinary characters as Sean Connery, Frank Sinatra, and Truman Capote. His Aunt Joan is Joan Didion. He shared an apartment in New York City with his best friend, Carrie, while he worked as an usher at Radio City, and she made a little science fiction pick called Star Wars. The anecdotes include being babysat by Elizabeth Montgomery, late-night dinners with Debbie Reynolds, being groped by Tennessee Williams, and doing hits of acid provided him personally by Timothy Leary. But a life full of notables is rarely free of trauma. The Dunn family is gifted and glamorous and riddled with complexities that include mental illness, addiction, rivalries, social climbing, family secrets, and murder. Griffin's father, Dominic Dunn, was a destitute, closeted, alcoholic Hollywood has-been when he became a celebrated Vanity Fair writer with his account of the trial of the man who murdered Griffin's sister and Dominic's daughter, Dominique. This is one of many troublesome twists that Griffin has processed and illustrated for us with wisdom and grace. Sharing this intimate account of his marvelously messy family encourages us to better embrace the dramatic characters in our own lives. Griffin's writing is sharp and funny, and it breathes plenty of life into the fascinating figures in the Dunn family. You come away feeling as if you know each person, especially Griffin. You may wish to complement this book with Griffin's documentary about his aunt Joan Didion, The Center Will Not Hold. It's on Netflix, and a documentary on his father, Dominic Dunn, After the Party, which I found on Prime.
I love him. I love his whole family. They're all talented. And his uncle, who was Joan Didion's husband, was John Gregory Dunn, who was also a very noted author as
absolutely,
well.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Awesome.
All well depicted in this beautiful book. Let's welcome our wonderful guest. Richard Carruthers Little, O.C., Order of Canada, is a comedian, impressionist, voice actor, known as the Man of a Thousand Voices. He's recorded 9 comedy albums, appeared all over television for decades, including 3 HBO specials. He's done impressions of presidents, 4 presidents, and he is right here with us right now. Please welcome Rich Little.
Yay! We've been looking forward to this, Rich. Welcome.
Rich Little, is he still alive?
Yeah.
Looking pretty good.
Doing awesome.
If he can survive 115-degree heat in Las Vegas.
No, he's doing awesome. So I want to go, but let's go back a little bit to the beginning, because your family was political, and you began your career impersonating Canadian politicians. So give us a little of a Canadian politician that we have never heard of, but we will enjoy learning more about.
Well, when I was growing up in Canada, when I was a little, the prime minister... This is back in the, in the 50s, was John Diefenbaker.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked like an owl.
Okay.
And he was a very interesting man because he was very controversial, and you either liked him or hated him. But because he looked like an owl, and you know, a lot of people in Canada think that I'm an owl. I don't pay any attention to that at all. I don't give a hoot.
you also did some people, such a specific impression. You even did Ottawa Mayor Charlotte Whitten, which launched you to great success in the Ottawa Metroplex.
Yes.
Can you remember how to do her?
Oh, yeah. She was... a feisty little mayor of Ottawa, and she's only about 5 feet tall, and she had a voice like this. Rich Little, I'm trying to chop down a tree up here at my cottage on Bear Lake. And I want you to grab a hold of the rope, and when I chop it down, you pull on the rope. And then my friend said, you know, my father is campaigning for opposition, so let the rope go slack. And we did, and then the tree fell on the house.
Oh, wow.
Oh my God, that's funny. So you were a middle child growing up in Ottawa, Canada, the land of nice people. What was it like to grow up there?
Well, Ottawa was a great little city, and I grew up there, and and I had all my favorite entertainers. I love Jimmy Stewart, and I love Jack Benny, and I love John Wayne. And I never dreamed when I was a teenager that within 10 years I'd be working with all these people.
Wow.
That was just mind-boggling for me.
And you showed your talent at a very young age. You showed your acting skills at a very young age, working in community theater.
Yeah, I was wanted to be a serious actor, and I did a lot of plays, amateur plays, in Ottawa at the Little Theater, not named after me, but was a great training ground for me because I did a lot of plays, mostly dramas, actually, other than comic shows. And I got sort of sidetracked into doing impressions and forgot about acting for a long time. And then later on in my career, you know, I did Police Story, and I did my Hawaii 5-0, and did a lot of dramatic things, but that was a lot later.
You used to work in a cinema in your local area there, and would try to imitate the people you saw on the screen, which was great practice for you.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I saw Marty, the movie Marty, because I was an usher in the theater. And I saw that about 28 times. Mm. You know, I would be watching the movie and people were stumbling because they couldn't find their seats. And I saw Marty so many times, I knew all the dialogue. And when I met Ernest Borgnine for the first time, I started to do the dialogue from Marty in front. And he turned to me and he said, "Hey, Rich, you know it better than I do, for heaven's
sake." Wow. That's amazing.
That may be the only Ernest Borgnine impression in existence.
No, but
that
it's,
was very
it's
good.
Perfect.
But when he passed away, you know, he was doing a cartoon and they hadn't finished it. And I went in and finished it for them, did his voice.
You know, that's an interesting, you brought it up, and that was an interesting part of your career. You would do looping. For instance, on Pink Panther, and looping is for people, you many times you go in afterwards, if there's an imperfection in the sound recording or something, you'll go in, or the actor himself will go in and do it, but sometimes the actor couldn't do it.
They passed away.
Yeah, well, see, that's bad. Then they can't come to the looping session.
Or if they had laryngitis, like I did. I did the voice of Gene Kelly for a Christmas special.
Wow.
Nobody knew I did it because... they never said that Rich Little did the voice, but he had lost his voice. He had laryngitis.
So is there any difference, Rich, in how you would do looping, which would be an exact replica, and how you would do an impression for laughs?
Well, you know, when I was looping a movie, I would have to do it exactly the way they were.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I mean, in my act, I exaggerate a little bit, but not much.
Okay, not much. Yeah. So you went, I think the first show you were on in the States was Judy Garland. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's true.
And she was a big fan of yours.
In 64.
Yeah. So what did she enjoy watching you do?
Well, she was great. I didn't see much of her because she didn't come to rehearsal. And that was a plus for me because when I did the show, she hadn't seen my routine. So when you look at it today, you don't really look at me, you look at her, because her reaction is unbelievable, because she'd never seen me do the routine before, you know, which is very unusual, because usually when you do a TV show, you work with the person, you know, whose show it was, all week long. But with Judy Garland, she just didn't show up until the last minute. And even at the last minute, she had trouble showing up.
And you had a killer James Mason impersonation, who was her co-star in A Star Is Born, and that was the sealer for you right there.
That's right, James Mason. That was the voice that got me on the Judy Garland show.
Oh, wow.
Because Mel Torme, the singer, was a great friend of mine, and we did a television show in Toronto together. And he was so overcome with my impressions of all these people that he said, "I'm going to get you on the Judy Garland show."
Whoa.
So I put a lot of my impressions on a tape, and he brought it over to Judy Garland's house, and he said, "I'm going to play this tape for you because this guy, Rich Little, is unbelievable, and I want to get him on the show." And Judy turned to Mel and said, "Mel, I don't want to hear the tape. I don't like impersonators. They make me fart." That's what she said.
That's an interesting reaction.
Well, yeah, especially since George Slaughter told us how much he enjoyed that.
She did hear my impression of James Mason.
She did. Oh, so that's
true. Listened to that on the tape, and she went, "Oh, my God, that's incredible." Mm-hmm. So that's how I got on the Judy Garland show, was because of my impression of James Mason. And then about a month after I did the show, I ran into James Mason at some charity event. And I said, "Mr. Mason, I want to thank you for getting me on the Judy Garland show." And he looked at me and he said, "What are you talking about?" "Well, I did an impression of you for Judy Garland, and that's how I got on the Garland show." "How much did they pay you?" "How much did they pay me? I think I got about $800 for doing it." "Oh, good. Because considering you did me on the show, send me half of that money."
Before you came to the States, you did something that I'd never seen done before. You actually had a partner Jeff Scott, who also did impressions, and you guys won a talent contest. So how did that work? How did a twofer of impressionists work on stage?
Well, we would do, I'd do Dean Martin and he'd do Jerry Lewis and, that kind of thing. We were kind of a partnership, and we did a lot of shows in Canada. And then his mother and father said, Jeff, you got to think about a career. Doing impressions is going nowhere, and you got to make money and have a career, so stop doing impressions. And he did. And I went on doing impressions, and poor Jeff, he never amounted really to anything.
Wow. Well, you enjoy creating elaborate scenarios within which all these various voices can be speaking to each other. Describe some of those, because those are fun.
Well, before I did impressions, I was an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And I did portraits. And I still do them today. And I've done over, 1,000 portraits over the years. You know, and a lot of them, I'll show you a couple of that I think are my favorites.
Tom Selleck.
Dang.
Yeah.
Selleck.
That's
very
beautiful.
Good.
Tom Cruise.
Wow.
It's people named Tom.
You know who this is?
Tom Trump.
Good for you.
Kamala Harris wants to be president in the worst way. Mission accomplished.
So do you use pencil or is it charcoal? Is that your medium?
It's charcoal. Yeah. Charcoal. Yeah. Wow. Remember this guy?
Oh, wow, man. Johnny. Yeah.
Johnny Carson. Mr. Carson. You had
Johnny Carson. The Tonight Show, I hosted it 24 times.
Wow. Yeah, you were like the periodic sit-in.
That show helped me a lot.
And then you got to play him in the late shift movie.
Yes, it's true. Yeah, I did.
But talk about, this is not a secret. Talk about your less than perfect divorce from Mr. Carson later on. What was that all about?
Well, I had a falling out. I don't know whether it was Johnny Carson. It might have been with the director, producer on the show, Fred DeCordova. Yeah, all of a sudden I was a notebook on the show.
That's crazy.
And I never found out why. Never found out why. But I did find out that a lot of people were a notebook on the Carson show. And a lot of them, like Torme, the singer, he was a notebook on the Tonight Show. He didn't know why either. So, it's just something I never got to the bottom of.
I remember some of your performances on The Tonight Show, and they were always hysterical. And Johnny was a great audience for you.
I met him, I was an old book on the show, but about a year before he passed away, I met him at a restaurant in Malibu, and he was very nice to me.
Wow.
He came up to me and he said, "Rich, are you still doing me in your act?" Yeah, I'm doing you all the time, John. But I'm not on television. I know, but people remember you. They'll always remember you. But I find that hard to believe. And do they react? I said, yeah. Isn't that funny? He was so insecure that he didn't think I'd be doing him anymore. And here we are like 50 years later and I'm still doing him.
Right. Wow. And it's not like he didn't record his shows. There's, it's like it's not going anywhere. The body of work will be forever online somewhere or available to everyone. That's a voice we'll always know, just like we'll always know the voice of James Cagney or Jimmy Stewart.
He could be a tough cookie.
But to me, one of the boldest things you did, and you did it with so much confidence that it's like staggering, but you would do people in front of people at these celebrity roasts.
Yeah.
Were you scared?
That's one of the reasons I did so many Dean Martin roasts. I did 24 of those. I did more than anybody else. And I think the reason I got on so many was if they had 4 or 5 people could impersonate on the days, they would book me on because they knew I'd be imitating them in front of them. And people love that, So that's why I did 24.
Oh, yeah, you find yourself looking back and forth, looking at you, looking at George Burns, looking at you. Is he laughing or is he just pretending to laugh? Like, it's so fascinating.
Let me ask you a question about that. I've always wondered that, not only about you, but about the other performers on the roast. Did they create that material for you? Of course, you did your own impressions, obviously, but did they write the jokes for you, or did you bring your own material to that?
What they would do was they would send you a list of jokes you could use on the roast.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd get them and I'd look at them and say, that second one is pretty funny. I could use that. Now, I don't like those two jokes. And then I would put some of my own material into it. So I'd end up doing one or two things that they prepared, and then the rest of it was me. But if you had an actress or an actor on the show that wasn't a comedian, they would just do the jokes they were sent.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure. Yeah.
And sometimes it didn't work because they weren't comedians, so they didn't have the timing.
Right.
They would keep, though somebody on that really didn't go over very well, they would keep them on the roast if they were a very popular person.
Mm-hmm.
And then they would add in people reacting to their jokes that were pretty lame from other shows.
Oh, that's interesting.
Wow.
To make them look good.
Okay.
A lot of the times when you watch those roasts today and there are people laughing at somebody, they're laughing at another show.
Yeah. They still sell those things.
Oh, laugh tracks.
DVDs like in the middle of the night. Crazy.
Yeah, they're still very popular. Yeah, people tell me that, you know, when it's kind of a boring night on television, they just get out an old Dean Martin roast and think they're hysterical. And most of them do.
Oh, no, it's so much fun, you and Jack Benny. And, you know, and there you are with these legendary figures doing them right in front of them. It's just the best.
All the people that I admired when I was a teenager.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how you contained your composure or how you got yourself up for that moment, because to me it seems just like going right into the line of fire. But you were always so graceful and elegant and just perfection.
Well, that was the most pressure I ever had doing the roast, because not only a lot of people watched the roast, I mean, it had a big following, but you were working in front of some of the greats of Hollywood, mm-hmm. some of the greatest comics that ever were. And so if you look down the dais and thought about that for a minute, you might start to mumble. And a lot of people did. Yeah, there were a lot of people that didn't end up on the roast because they just froze. But what you had to do is just forget about that and just concentrate on what you're doing. So I would say in my career that the roast and doing The Tonight Show, particularly when I hosted it, those were the most, that was the most pressure I ever had in my career.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Now, would anyone speak to you afterward? Jack Benny or George Burns, would they speak to you afterwards about how you did them? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. They loved it when I impersonated them, you know. And they got a big kick out of it. I think Reagan got the biggest kick out of my impression than anybody.
Great sense of humor.
Yeah.
Talk about the time you did
Reagan
Nixon.
Reagan would say, Rich, I think you do me better than I do.
That's very good.
Wow.
Talk about the time you did Nixon, and Nixon didn't know you were doing Nixon. And said, "Why?"
That's right. Well, you know, that's true. I was down in San Clemente and at a garden party that Nixon threw. And here's a picture of me.
Oh, my gosh.
With Nixon. Can you see that?
Yeah.
And I got up and I did my impression of him in front of him. And he didn't know who I was doing.
Wow.
Well, not entirely self-aware is what I'm guessing about.
I see a coffee table book.
Very little photos. Sense of humor, Nixon did.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He was pretty stiff, you know. But, you know, that's to be expected because he wore the same blue suit, I think, for over 40 years. And he never took the hanger out of it. So it was pretty stiff, you know, not much of a sense of humor. And when I did him in front of him, he turned to his wife, Pat, and said, "Why is this young man speaking in this strange voice?"
Wow, that's amazing.
Well, what is the most adverse reaction you ever got from a victim that you had just impersonated?
Paul Lynn of Hollywood Squares.
Oh, he didn't. Uh-oh.
He hated my impression.
What did he say?
He used to, when I would do them on Hollywood Squares, I would start to imitate him. They would cut to a shot of him reacting, and he'd look into the camera and go, "How's he doing?" Disgusting. Get a day job. Oh my God, that's awful.
Wow.
Hated it. Absolutely hated it. But it was a good impression for me to do, you know, because he was a very popular guy on Hollywood Squares.
Yeah.
You know.
And he had a very distinct way of communicating. So when
yeah,
when you
he
do
was an alcoholic, you know, and that
oh.
And there were times when they had to strap him into the chair.
Well, yeah, I mean, you're up several flights, hanging on some sort of.
Well, after the dinner break, he wouldn't eat the dinner; he would just drink, and then he was totally bombed a couple of times, and they had to literally strap him into the chair and prop him up, and he still was funny.
Yeah, the guy was, you know, he was gifted. When you perfect an impression, it's not just the voice, it's the facial expressions, the mannerisms, the bearing, et cetera. Does it all come naturally to you, or do you have to work on certain aspects?
Well, you have to work at it.
Yeah. So which comes first, and how do you build it?
Well, you know, you try and watch them as much as you can, and you keep trying to improve it. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. You know, I was never able to imitate Barack Obama, not that I wanted to, you know, even Trump is hard to do because most people do Trump with kind of the lip thing, you know, and I never thought of him that way. I think of him more as, let's see, where's this picture? I had it here. Donald Trump. If I can see him, I can do it better.
Yeah, yeah. I understand how that works. Yeah, you embody them.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, Wheezy was talking about your ability to create little scenarios with many voices at once. You also did Dickens' A Christmas Carol, where you played 22 characters. But the sad timing of it was it got pulled off the shelves because JFK had been assassinated, and you had JFK doing the Ghost of Christmas Present, and of course it had to be taken off the show.
That was the record, not the television show.
Yeah,
made a record of it called Scrooge and the Stars was the name of it, and I did the whole story with people playing different parts, and I had JFK playing the Ghost of Christmas Yet to Come.
Oh,
just before released the album, he was assassinated. So I had to go back in and recast him with Lloyd Bridges.
We're good.
Okay.
Treasure hunt.
So that did that album.
There are still copies out there of Kennedy playing the voice of Christmas Past.
And you did it on HBO too, right? You did it as a special.
Did it on HBO and it won an Emmy and played all the characters and you know, they write to me and say that they play it every Christmas. So that's
unbelievable.
Very nice of them.
And they must have cut it together. Did you change costumes back and forth between the various characters?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, because I'm talking to myself.
Yeah, man.
You know, I'm playing all the parts. So when I'm speaking to somebody, I'm speaking to myself as another character. So it was all in the editing. I think there were about 800 edits in the show.
Wow.
When folks come out to see you in the year of our Lord 2024, what impressions get the biggest laugh? What resonates the most with folks?
Well, you know, if you follow my career and know what I do, you want to hear Johnny Carson, you want to hear John Wayne, and you want to hear Jimmy Stewart, and of course Reagan, you know. And if you're getting a little more up to date, you do Joe Biden. Kamala Harris is very easy to do because you just have to laugh. You don't have to say anything. You just laugh at everything.
Let's hear the laugh. Can I hear the laugh? okay, what did Biden just say to her that elicited that response? Let's hear a little of Joe.
Hey, man. You chumps out there. My name is is, oh God, what a tough one. happy birthday to me. Joe Biden, I'd like to list you a number of my accomplishments during my presidency. Have you got a second? And then I go off eating an ice cream cone.
Yeah.
You had the distinction of having you had the distinction of having Ed Sullivan introduce you as Little Richard.
That's true.
They must have had to stop tape at that point.
He was also strapped into his chair.
On the Ed Sullivan show, he introduced me as Little Richard. And I stumbled out on stage like a deer caught in the headlights. I didn't know what to do. And I started my routine. And I suddenly got a burst of enthusiasm because I realized if I bombed on the show, they wouldn't blame me. They'd blame Little Richard.
There you go.
So
sure.
I finished my routine and went to the dressing room. And Ed finally figured out what happened, came to my dressing room to apologize. And he said to me, Ricardo, he always thought I was Mexican. I want to know that they had it written on the cards all wrong.
Oh, I'm sure that's what it was.
Throwing someone under the bus.
Oh, man,
there you go.
Funny.
That's the apology right there. It was someone else's fault.
He was a very strange man, Ed Sullivan.
Yeah.
Very difficult to get along with. You know, he everybody was scared to death of him because he was Mr. Show Business.
Mm-hmm.
I remember the first time my agent tried to get me on the Ed Sullivan show, and he said, well, what does he do? And he said, well, he does impressions of a lot of the big stars. Well, why would I book him on our show when I can get the real one?
Wow.
Which is a good
That's hysterical.
Do people come up to you and do their impressions for you?
Oh, yeah. All the time. Yeah.
And how do you respond and react?
Well, sometimes I don't know who they're doing.
That's not a good sign.
I sort of smile and say, hey, that's pretty good, you know. Don't give up your day job, but not that, you know, keep working at it, you know. But sometimes they're awful. Sometimes they surprise you. You know, you'll sometimes run into somebody who does a pretty good impression, you know. And but most of the time it's kind of thin, you know. But you try to be nice.
Of course.
You don't put anybody down. But that happens to me a lot, you know.
No, I would imagine.
I was in McDonald's a couple of weeks ago, and I sneezed in the restaurant, and somebody behind me said, who are you doing?
Talk about that show, The Copycats, in 1972, where you had all the great impressionists in the world on one TV show.
That's right. That was a good show.
Yeah.
Done in England. We did that show
Frank
in England.
Frank Gorshin, Marilyn Michaels.
There were a lot of wonderful impersonators on that show. Frank Gorshin, George Kirby, Marilyn Michaels, Fred Travellina. And it was a fun show to do. And we got a lot of big stars on the show, too.
And how did that work? What was the format? What was the format of that show?
Well, we did takeoffs on movies, television shows. And we had great writers. And the sets were marvelous. And the interesting thing was that we booked on actors and actresses that had never done impressions before. And they loved it. You know, I remember we had Robert Young on the show, and he did a W.C. Fields. Pretty darn good, too. So that always intrigued people, you know. We had Raymond Burr on the show, and he was fabulous. So we had a lot of great, wonderful people on that show.
Sounded fun.
Yeah. So now you've broken the record for the longest running one-man show in Las Vegas. Now in its eighth year, you're looking for a new venue because I guess the Tropicana is closing down, correct, with the Laugh Factory?
Yeah. I'm kind of talking away, but I'm going down in about
Covina.
2 weeks. Yeah?
You're going to Covina to the Laugh Factory. September 8th.
Yeah, the Laugh Factory there. I'm looking forward to that. So I'll come out of retirement to do that show, and I've been working on it, and I'm doing a parody on Camelot, with Richard Burton singing Pamela.
Oh, can we hear a little of that?
Yeah, Richard Burton. 2 months ago, she couldn't get her numbers were so bad, the worst we saw. But there's a bright tomorrow going forward for Camelot.
Oh, that's awesome.
So are you going to show your art, and you have some...
I'm going to show a lot of my art.
Film clips.
Every time I impersonate somebody, I show a picture I drew of them. I'm also going to show a lot of clips from television shows that I've done.
In other words,
when I do George Burns, I will then show me on the screen working with George Burns.
Wow.
Or with John Wayne, and I show me with John Wayne or Dean Martin. So I do a lot of film clips from a lot of shows that I've done in the past, and then I do the voices that I'm known for, and then a couple of new ones, and that'll be the show.
So it's really a multimedia one-man show.
Yeah.
A lot of fun.
So, speaking of John Wayne, when you became an American citizen,
oh, yeah.
I love this, at the swearing-in ceremony, the judge in charge of the proceedings said, I want you to do the Pledge of Allegiance as John Wayne.
And that's right.
And probably convulsed the whole room of new citizens.
Oh, my God. He was a big John Wayne fan. And so I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States, Pilgrim. And he loved it, you know. And so I became, I was a little concerned when I got out of there because I thought, wait a minute, did I become an American citizen or did John Wayne? that was a great moment for me. And I've got dual citizenship because I was born in Canada. So mm-hmm. I'm half Canadian and half American.
How much work do you do in the United States?
Well, you know, I was touring around and doing a lot of shows before COVID, and that sort of put a stop to it.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the theaters now have no money and they're booking in acts they're not paying much money to. So it's been tough for me, you know, because I don't want to work for $50. Mm-hmm. But so the engagement at the Tropicana was great for me because I did four nights a week, and it was only half an hour from my house, and I did that for 8 years. You know?
So the Laugh Factory that we're all familiar with here in Los Angeles has closed because the Tropicana no longer exists, correct? So have they found a new venue for that? Because that was one of the...
No,
they
haven't found one in Vegas yet.
Hmm.
They're still looking.
Yeah, because that was really a good club. All the comedians that worked that room liked it in Vegas.
Yep.
Not all of them do well in Vegas, but that particular one did well.
Yeah, it really did well, yeah, yeah. But it's tough now because the casinos want so much money if you rent the room.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Sometimes if for somebody to put a show on there, you can't make much money because it costs you so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Tell us the story of the gift you received from Jack Benny.
A gift you received?
Yeah, he sent you something with an inscription.
Yeah, a money clip, I think, once. Yeah, he gave me a Jack Benny money clip. I wonder where that is. I have no idea where that is. That would be something to keep.
Yeah, because on the back it said, with Bob Hope doing my walk and you doing my voice, I can be a star and do nothing.
Where did you hear that?
That's on your Wikipedia.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh, I've forgotten about that. I wonder where that is. Well, I don't know.
It's probably worth a boatload of money.
You
better
find it. You lose a lot of things, you know. But,
Yeah, for sure.
Let me mention a few people and give me your impression of working with them and being on their shows. Jackie Gleason.
Jackie Gleason?
Mm-hmm.
How sweet it is. I love Jackie Gleason. He was wonderful. And I did a show with Jackie Gleason in Vegas. And I forget what it was for, but I was on the show, and he was the MC. And I still have a clip of that, which I show in my show. And Gleason was terrific with me, except he was totally bombed out of his mind.
Whoa!
Another guy that didn't
rehearse.
During
the routine, he was drinking.
Wow!
While we did the routine, he was drinking booze.
Wow!
If you look at it, you don't see any sign of him being drunk at all. He was absolutely perfect. Yeah.
With his girth, he had a big tolerance for alcohol.
You know.
What about Mike Douglas?
One time on the Dean Martin roast, when the roast was over and I was getting up to leave, I picked up Dean's glass that he had in front of him, and I sniffed it, and I didn't detect any booze.
Hmm.
Well, some people say that whole thing was a bit of a put-on.
Well,
he,
it was, yeah.
He wasn't as
I mean, he was a drinker. We know that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I don't think he drank. I think that Frank and Sammy drank much more than Dean.
Yeah. Wow.
So can you do an impression of the entire Rat Pack?
Well, let me think. I can do Sammy. I do a Ferris Sinatra. And I don't do Joey Bishop, but I don't consider him really a member of the Rat Pack. But he was. But who else was there?
Peter Lawford.
Well, Dean and Frank and Sammy, really.
And Peter Lawford.
I do all three of them. Yeah.
Okay, let's hear a little Frank talk.
I love Dean.
Yeah, Dean.
Dean, in many ways, Dean was a bigger star than Frank Sinatra, if you think about it.
Yeah.
Wow.
He didn't have charisma quite that Frank had, but he sold more records. And I think movie-wise, they were about even.
And Dean had the show, so a lot of kids, my age.
Dean was a great success on television, and Frank wasn't.
Right. Yeah, he was a more, I think, approachable. It's almost like Frank was just so, you had to look up to him, and Dean was kind of like your guy, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, Dean was, he was lackadaisical. Nothing bothered him.
Mm-hmm.
Sail through life. He wanted to do things quickly, too.
He didn't rehearse either, right? He was one of those
guys. That's why he did the roast, because he didn't have to rehearse. He just showed up at the last minute. Didn't even know who the guest of honor was.
Wow.
And could guess.
Wow.
He was only there for about an hour and a half, and then he showed up a week later and did another show and didn't know who the guest was, and that suited him fine because he didn't have to rehearse.
Wow, you've had some great acting roles. I mean, on iconic television shows. In 1967, you did That Girl with Marlo Thomas.
Yeah.
In 66 and 67, you appeared on the Judy Garland show. And, of course, she was made famous on Laugh-In.
Yeah.
He was on Petticoat Junction.
Was he? Were you really?
Yeah. Petticoat Junction? Yeah, I did that show.
Wow. You played an accident-prone priest on The Flying Nun.
Yeah, that's right. Brother Paul.
That's at the
Brother
top.
Paul. I think I did three episodes with Sally Fields, and when I met her a couple of years ago, she didn't remember me.
Oh.
Oh, well.
Were you wearing a frock?
I wasn't wearing.
All right. I want to talk about your one-man show, Trial on the Potomac. It was based on the 2015 book, The Real Watergate Scandal, Collusion,
right.
Conspiracy, and the Plot to Bring Down Nixon. And
that's
it was
right.
An off-Broadway success. Talk about what the book was about and how you did it. Was it a one-person show? You did Nixon the whole time?
Well, Jeff Sessions, who wrote the book on the Watergate scandal, he put together this show that we did on off-Broadway, actually. Mm-hmm. And it didn't do that well because of COVID. We didn't get the audience.
Oh.
But it was a great show. And it was a very dramatic show. And Trisha Nixon came to see the show and thought I was perfect as her father.
Wow.
I had tears running down my cheeks watching you do my father.
Oh,
you know? Amazing. The makeup was extraordinary, you know.
Was it a one-person show, or were there other actors in it?
Oh, no. We had a good cast.
Oh, okay.
About six or eight people in the show.
What was the arc of the book? What was the book about?
Well, it was kind of like talking about Watergate and what happened, and at the end of the show. We say, was Nixon guilty or was he innocent? And we take, we ask the audience what they think when the show was over to see whether they thought Nixon was guilty or innocent. And most of the time, they voted that he was innocent.
Wow.
Well, that's based on the people who are attending that particular show. So it might be sort of a skewed survey.
Well, you know, compared to what's going on today, I don't think Watergate was a big deal, really.
Well, he did a lot of dirty tricks that Watergate was just among one of. He had
they all do dirty tricks, don't they?
Well, who actually knows for sure? We don't. We only know what we can suss out or what reporters have investigated. And in the case of Nixon, I think he was going to do whatever he needed to do to get reelected. So, you know, bugging the Democratic headquarters seems pretty tame compared to like a lot of what's going on today. I will agree with you there.
I agree with that.
You made an interesting comment about doing impressions constantly of the older stars, like Bogart and Jimmy Stewart. You say because it's so hard to do the current stars. Like, how do you do Brad Pitt? How do you do George Clooney? They don't have those obvious idiosyncrasies that the older stars had.
Yeah.
That's a great comment. I mean, a great observation.
Really, absolutely right. It's harder to do the actors of today. You know, Harrison Ford, how do you do him?
Mm-hmm.
How do you do Tom Selleck? Mm-hmm. You know,
is there anyone you can do, or are you listening when you see someone, when you watch a movie and you see like sort of a new, like all these actors named Chris, you know, I don't even know the difference between any of those people. But are you looking for different idiosyncrasies that would make it so that you could do an impression of something that you could hang on to and do an impression of when you watch movies?
Yeah. Well, I think it helps if you're a fan of somebody, because then you want to see them as often as you can. And if you see somebody long enough on TV, eventually the voice will come to you. But there's a lot of actors today that I'm not interested in, so I really don't think about imitating.
You know, the other thing, Rich, is that we're not all looking in the same direction anymore. We used to all watch the same movies and all watch the same TV shows on three channels, and now there's so much streaming media, and it's just so diffused. We're all looking all over the place. So who exactly is that well known that people would know the voice?
Yeah, that's true. That's very true.
You know, and that's why the old, you know, when you're doing some of these legendary stars, their legacy is set. You know, people, those movies will run forever on Turner Classic Movies or what have you. So those voices they're indelible, right? So you do the people that are indelible. It's hard to get indelible nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I'm thinking if you didn't have the American movie classics, do you think a lot of these people would be passé?
No, there's more than Turner Classic Movies. There's the MGM channel. There's so many channels.
That's true. And, you know, I think the older movies are the better movies.
Yeah.
But I know a lot of people, like one of my ex-wives, who would never watch a black and white movie.
Seriously?
And I said,
I love
why?
Black and white movies.
She said, because life's in color. And I said, really? And she said, yeah, that's why I won't watch a black and white movie, because life's in color. And I said to her, what if you lived in Seattle?
Rich, I used to think that my mom's childhood was in black and white. So, I mean, I kind of get it.
I love black and white.
So do I. It's more artistic. So talk about your salty encounter with Betty Davis.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah. Well, I phoned her up, Jimmy Stewart, and she thought it was really Jimmy.
Jimmy?
I had to admit it was me calling her, and she swore at me and hung up.
Okay, so let's reenact this. You call her as Jimmy Stewart. Go ahead.
I called her as Jimmy Stewart to ask her why she didn't come to Reagan's inauguration, and I phoned her up as Jimmy Stewart, and she thought it was really Jimmy. And when she found out that I was Rich Little calling, she swore at me and hung up.
Okay.
So later in the day, when I met Ronald Reagan and Jimmy Stewart, one of the inaugural parties, we told him what happened, and Reagan was really shocked because he loved Betty Davis. So he got a hold of a telephone, and Reagan phoned up Betty Davis to, try and tell her that it was all in fun. And when Betty Davis answered the phone, she still thought it was me, and she told Reagan to go to hell.
Really? That's rich.
Well, you did a one-man show about Jimmy Stewart.
Actually, it was stronger than Go to Hell.
Yeah, it was Go Fuck Yourself. We were trying to get you to say it, but you were being too much of a gentleman.
You used the F word, and that was it, and hung up.
Yeah.
Wow, what a saucy gal. Yeah.
Talk about your Jimmy Stewart one-man show. I would have loved to have seen that.
Well, I did a tribute to Jimmy Stewart, and I thought I was going to go to Broadway, you know, and it didn't, you know. If it went to Broadway, it would probably be on the street.
So was it the life of Jimmy Stewart?
It was a pretty good show, but it just didn't take off.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah, that was.
Do you take suggestions from the audience do you ever take suggestions from the audience in your live shows, like who would you like to hear me do type thing, or no?
Well, people come up to me after a show or, you know, make a comment, you know. Sometimes they're complimentary. Sometimes they say things I didn't think about what they were saying.
Oh, I understand that.
Like a couple would say, hey, we wanted to catch your show tonight before you died.
Oh, wow.
You wouldn't want to catch my show after I died, you know. Or so many strange things they say to me, like, is this the same show we're seeing tonight that you did in 1962? You know, I had a 15-year-old kid one day come in to see my show, sat down front, and was screaming with laughter. As I watched him, I said to myself, he doesn't know anybody I'm doing. He's 15. He couldn't possibly. So I called him over when the show was over, and I said, God, you seem to enjoy my show. He said, Mr. Little, you were hysterical. But I was confused. I said, you were confused about what? He said, well, as I watched you, I wonder why you kept changing your voice.
He was just laughing at the jokes.
Yeah. Just laughing at the jokes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that is so interesting.
Who,
wow.
Other than yourself, who do you think is the best in the art form or was the best in the art form?
You mean a comedian?
Yeah, impressionist.
As an impressionist?
Who is somebody that you looked up to?
Gosh, there were a number of them that I looked up to. There's a lady here in Vegas. She teaches piano, and I had her in the show I did called Copycats, and she's brilliant, but she never really went anywhere, but best impersonator I ever heard, Kathy Walker.
What's her name?
Other than Kathy Walker, she was brilliant. And I still talk to her today, and she's a wonderful lady and a great conservative, and we have that in common. So I would say Frank Gorshin was pretty good.
Frank was amazing.
I think that George Kirby was great.
Yeah.
Fred Carolina was wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Then Debbie Reynolds was a marvelous impersonator.
Oh, that's so
Debbie Reynolds? Mm-hmm. Really?
Huh?
Debbie Reynolds? Who would
Debbie
she do?
Debbie Reynolds was wonderful.
Who would she do?
She did a great Betty Davis. She did, she did Pearl Bailey. She did a lot of impressions, you know.
You did something that Vaughn Meader did in the United States, which was he did the album
Family.
The First Family about the Kennedys. And
right,
you did a very similar concept called My Fellow Canadians.
Yeah, in Canada.
I always wondered if Vaughn Meader you obviously had a career far beyond doing Canadian politicians, but did Vaughn Meader have any sort of a career outside of doing Kennedy impersonations for the rest of his life?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
I can't think of anything.
Uh-uh.
But, you know, people at the time when that album came out thought he sounded more like Kennedy than Kennedy did. And when I started to imitate Kennedy, if I didn't do my impression of Vaughn Meader doing him, they didn't think it was any good.
Oh, wow.
So I don't think he did anything other than that.
No, you know? I don't think he did any other impersonations.
All right, so we're going to talk about the show that's coming up on September 8th.
Sunday.
And it's going to be at Covina. There's a Laugh Factory in Covina. And what do people need to do to get tickets? Go to laughfactory.com?
Yep. That's where they go.
We'll have the website posted.
7 o'clock, and And I'm going to be doing all my routines. I think I'm going to do about 20 impressions in the show.
It's called Rich Little Live. You're going to have
and
clips.
And you can also buy my book if you are looking for a gift for somebody.
Oh, yes. Oh, nice. Wonderful. And that's an autobiography?
No. This is funny things that have happened with me and celebrities down through the years.
Oh.
And everybody I impersonated in this book, I drew a picture of.
Oh. You know,
I was talking about, I was talking about Don Rickles. I would draw a picture of Don and then talk about Don Rickles.
You know? Wow.
That's amazing.
That is so good.
Yeah.
I mean,
I talk about 20 or 30 people in the book.
You opened for a lot of famous people. Who was the loveliest person you ever opened for? Juliet Prowse or no?
Oh, yeah. She was wonderful. Mm-hmm. You know, I opened for a number of very talented women. Lena Horne, I opened for her at the Sands Hotel. And, you know, Susan Anton, who I still talk to today, a lovely lady. And,
yeah, she lives in Las Vegas. We had her on.
Yeah, we had her on.
We had her on. She lives in Las Vegas now. She and her husband are very successful.
Yeah, she's terrific.
Yeah.
Love her. And Bernadette Peters, I worked with her.
Wow.
And, you know, Sandy Duncan.
Who was the most supportive person you ever opened for?
Well, Mel Torme.
Oh, there you go.
Mel got me on the tonight.
Oh, that's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think I remember hearing him tell the story on Johnny, where his mother, I guess, saw the billboard and it said Rich Little Mel Torme, and she came up to him and she said, "You know, I know that you're not very large and that you make a lot of money, but do you really have to bill yourself as Rich Little Mel Torme?"
Rich Little Mel Torme.
there he is. I love that face.
Velvet Fog. He used to call me when I was doing the weather in Los Angeles, because he would drive to Las Vegas on the weekends on Friday night, and he would call me and ask me if it was foggy along the 15 on the way to Las Vegas, and I'd check all my data. And...
Well, did you tell him whether or not it was velvet foggy?
Oh, yeah. I think that's why he wanted me to. That's right.
Yeah, you know, Mel was such a movie buff.
Mm-hmm.
He knew everything about movies. If you'd watch Spartacus and they showed a shot of the Colosseum, and they showed all the people in the Colosseum, Mel would say, "The guy I throw fourth in, his name is John Stone."
Wow. That's awesome. Yeah.
Well, what a pleasure to talk to you, sir. Really, I remember some huge laughs on The Tonight Show watching you growing up, Rich, and I'm glad to see you're still doing it and still enjoying it.
He's the champ.
Love talking to you both.
Thanks for coming along down the media path. Let's continue the conversation on Instagram and Twitter, where we are at Media Path Pod, and on Facebook, where our show page is Media Path Podcast, and our Facebook group is Media Path with Fritz and Wheezy Podcast Community. We are also a video podcast on YouTube with so much added visual content. Watch us and subscribe at Media Path Podcast. Write to us at MediaPathPodcast@gmail.com. Kindly give us a nice rating wherever you get your podcasts, and share our social media posts if you would love to brag about your excellent taste in podcasts. Our website is MediaPathPodcast.com. There you can catch up on episodes and binge our saucy newsletter loaded with photos and quizzes and backstage gossip. We want to thank our wonderful guest, Rich Little. Our team includes producer Dina Friedman, John Maddox, Bill Filipiak, Mason Brown, Garrett Arch, Raf Rusak, Jordan Reyes, Nick Broussard, and you. Our theme music is by me and John Maddox. I am Louise Blanker, here with Fritz Coleman and Rich Little. Be well and wise, and we will see you along the media path.
You repeat that.
Please don't make me.
Stay in front of your picture so we can just take a picture of you next
to
the monitor.
Just hold your pose for 30 seconds, Rich. Oops.